And before I begin, I say this. In 10 years of ministry, I don't think I've ever done this. I may have once, for you guys have really good memories. I have good memories, you might have said. I have done it another time. I can't remember when I did. But in 10 years, I have never not preached a sermon that I had planned for. I've heard other preachers do that. When they get up, I always think they just plan poorly, and that's why they did. And sometimes that was the case. But for a while, I've actually really, especially as a preacher through the Holy Spirit, I've really been sensing the Spirit laying kind of something on my heart for quite a while. And just the timing didn't work well. And so this afternoon, probably around 11 or 12 o'clock, I thought I'm not going to preach on what I was planning on preaching on. I was planning on preaching on Romans 8, 6, verses 10 and 11. I'm not going to do that. I planned it. Give you an idea, every weekend is the same routine for me as far as my sermon preparation goes. By Friday afternoon, my sermon is basically done. Saturday morning, I go over it, review it. I go over my head and I read through it. I go over my head on Saturday afternoon, I read through it again. Sunday morning, I read through it. And as of this Sunday morning, I read through it, went over it. And then usually Sunday afternoon, I'll go for a jog or a kayak or a bike or something like that. I'll go through it over just in my head, kind of get familiar with it so I can deliver it in a half decently communicated way. And I did that up until about 11 or 12 o'clock. I thought, I just don't want to preach on what I was about to preach on. Nothing having to do with it. It was done. It was just the way every other sermon has been done the last several years. But I thought, many things have led up to this point that I thought it would be appropriate to preach on. And so this, I basically sat down in my basement for about 2 or 3 hours and just typed up what I was going to preach today. It may come across as incoherent. It may come across as poorly edited because it was not edited. It may come across that I did not communicate it very well. That's probably a good possibility. But I'm going to preach on it anyways. I knew this, and Steve was preaching today. I thought, you know what, I probably will have less time anyways. So I thought, if I preach the other sermon, I might get looks or people falling asleep. At the length of it, so I thought maybe it could be a good time to do it anyways. I thought the next few weeks with Melissa being new, everything's tentative. Every meeting I have is tentative. Preaching is tentative, so I thought, I might not be back up here to preach for another few weeks. And we're entering into a busy time in the summer, so a lot of people could be on the way on vacation. And so I thought I want to do this sooner rather than later to get as many people as I can. And I know there's still a lot of people out here, so I'm going to encourage anybody, I'm going to put it on Facebook, make sure that even those who are not here but yet are part of the Grace Church family, they would hear what I'm about to say today. We always talk about being a family of families. And consider this kind of family meeting. Right? I don't know if you were a kid. As a kid, we had a family meeting. So everybody's come together. Maybe in your family, it's time for family meeting. We get around the dinner table, living room. And so consider this kind of a family meeting. Okay? Grace Church family meeting. So if you are not at Grace Church, if you were visiting or don't feel part of Grace Church for whatever reason, you're in a family meeting. Welcome. It may seem odd and weird, but you're in our family meeting. Many things have happened. Let me pray first. How about that? Pray and then I'll get into it. And we'll pray, sing, and go home from there. Dearly Father, God, thank you so much for your Spirit. Thank you for leading us and guiding us and teaching us and convicting us and moving us in such a way that we might pursue you all more. I pray that as we go about this today, looking at your body, I pray that you would be honored and glorified in it all. Stir the hearts of those of Grace Church to be the church you call us to be. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. A lot has happened in the last year of Grace Church. I've got to go through some ideas. We went to an hour, we went to the hour change. We moved to 4 o'clock over a year ago. We sold our building. Renaissance joined us, although just the Amps and Shavers remained, stayed with us. We love them. Pieces. We moved locations. We entered into a building that nobody had really built up a familiarity with. Even to this point, I hear many people saying the same thing. It doesn't feel like home, does it? Especially those that got really familiar and got really cozy in our old building. It's just something about it just doesn't feel cozy, right? It doesn't feel warm. It doesn't feel that same familiarity that we always had at the other building. A lot of renovations, constant renovations, so there's always something going on. It seems like we're constantly in flux. There's always, half the time, there's junk outside the corridor, the foyer. We finally got this bathroom done, but it's not even fully done yet. The morning leaves. They're all under renovation. Along the way, we've actually lost many individuals over this last year. Not having to do really with the move, per se. We've lost them in the last year. A few different people. We lost several, in fact. One notably, the Lasards, Karen Jarman, one of our elders. Karen, very, very highly involved. And then the last kind of, we had individuals that did not stay with us, Frank Ferrante and Jared D'Souza, that did not stay with us as we moved. We have individuals that make it harder to be here. Harold Appiah has difficulty making it here, given his schedule, his wife's schedule, Helen Appiah. Agnes Tetesian, she's with us today, finds a difficult time to be here. Making it here. And then finally, with John and Jess kind of heading off, I thought, man, it's just a lot of this seems the old guard is not here. And all that kind of lends us to the position we're in now. It just doesn't feel the same. Right? So if you've been around Grace Church for any amount of time, things just don't seem the same. It's resulted in kind of a changed guard, I feel, change of pace. Change of familiarity, change of comfort, and even possibly something that actually feels like a change of identity. For Grace Church, it just doesn't feel like the Grace Church that I joined, right? The Grace Church that I started pastoring maybe 10 years ago. In fact, the Grace Church I started pastoring 10 years ago is not the Grace Church that exists today, that God has worked with today. A lot has changed. Some of that's good, some of that's bad. So where it leaves us now, so you think, okay, what now? It's left us in this position of flux, this position of unfamiliarity a little bit, this position of just not feeling like the Grace Church we always were, this little identity crisis. And so today I wanted to kind of bring it back to really help us identify what truly is our identity. What are we doing? Where are we going? What are we supposed to be? And if we're not there, how are we supposed to get there? Let me suggest this. As a body, Grace Church body, we're called first a household of God. 1 Timothy 4:14. Paul writes this. 1 Timothy 4:14. Pull it up here. Writes this. Actually, 3. Told you what it meant. 3:14. I hope to come to you soon, but I am writing these things to you that if I delay, you may know how one ought to behave in the household of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and buttress of truth. First and foremost, we are a household. We're a household. We are family, families. I didn't make that up. When I call us a family of families, we are a family of families. And part of a family of families, it really necessitates homogeneity. Right? A heterogeneity. A homogeneity means we're all the same. Heterogeneity means we're all different. Right? So in a family, there's differences there, right? There is age differences. There are gender differences. Right? There's a mother, there's a father, there are kids, there are older siblings, there's an extended family, there are cousins and uncles. A family is somebody that you don't choose, but God chooses for you. And oftentimes, the church family is the exact same thing. You sometimes don't choose it, God chooses it for you. And it is heterogeneous in the sense that there are older people here, there are younger people here. There are middle-class people here, there are upper-class people here. There are those with money, there are those with less money. There are people that are odd, there are people that are not odd. Most of you are odd. You're wondering which class you're in. That's what the church is supposed to be. There are men, there are women, there are older, there are younger. Tall people, short people, funny people, weird people. This is what makes up the church. I don't believe in homogeneous churches, and I don't believe in niche churches. I don't believe in churches that have one specific demographic. Right? So this is the hipster church. Or this is the old congregation church. Right? Or this is this type of church. I don't believe in that. I think that is totally the opposite of what a biblical church is supposed to be. I think it's supposed to be a heterogeneous church in the sense that there are so many different people from all walks of life, all worshiping together. We never have services where it's nothing but older hymns and nothing but newer songs. I don't believe in that. There are many churches that have a service beforehand that is just old hymns. Where they have a service that's nothing but new hymns. I don't like that either. It fails. It avoids one demographic not to have to compromise or make do on account of somebody else. As a family, sometimes we're difficult. There will be squabbles and disagreements. In church, there will be squabbles and disagreements among people. But there mustn't ever be backbiting, gossip, or mean-spirited people. These are the people that Paul and the apostles accosted time and time again. If you are a gossiper, a backbiter, a mean-spirited person, you're not really welcome here. You can leave anytime you want. If you think, well, I don't gossip, I don't backbite, I'm not a mean-spirited person, maybe not, but it takes two of you. Right? So if I were you, you hear that, you hear gossip, backbite. Don't allow it. Don't allow that. There are going to be times when we go through periods of difficulty among them, but that's what families do. And I expect that. If you were in a homogeneic congregation, everybody's going to think the same and be the same, and that's just boring. We are secular pillar and buttress of truth, 1 Timothy 4:15. We preach and teach the Word of God as the Word of God. We claim Christ as Lord and Savior. We don't waver from doctrinal positions that we adhere to. If you've never read the Doctrinal Statement of Grace Church, read it. If you don't know what that is, ask me, and then read it. Understand what we believe and why we believe it. We are called the bride of Christ, the building of Christ, and the body of Christ. All that to say, this is the most important collaborative group of people in the entire world. You think the UN is important? You think some G20 summit or G8 summit is important? This is the most important institution in the entire world. We're the body of Christ, the bride of Christ, the building of Christ. So what we do on a Sunday afternoon is the most important thing and place that you can be at on a Sunday afternoon. The most important thing. If we're the most important group in the entire planet, because as the body, bride, and building of Christ, and I believe that fully, and the most important thing you could ever be doing is here worshiping among the saints, I believe that. If that's true, we need to make a point of gathering together regularly and doing this. If it's inconvenient to gather together on a Sunday afternoon, make it convenient. If there's something else that competes for your time, that's your fault. Don't let it compete for your time. Let it win every single time.
Sorry.
If there's something else going on, humbly refuse and gather together. Hebrews 10:25, the writer reminds us not to neglect the meeting together as is the habit of some. This is the most important thing you can be doing. Make a point. Make a point of being here, gathering together with the saints. It is the most important thing you could possibly be doing. We're called to do many things as a church. The main thing that we're called to do as a church, Grace Church, is to mature. To mature. You've heard me say it, and I'll say it 100 other times. God has called us to mature. His will for us as a church is for us to collaboratively mature together. His will for you as an individual is to mature. There are books written on what is the will of God. God's will is your maturity. That's what God's will is. Colossians 1, 28, 29, Him we proclaim. Paul says, warning everyone, teaching everyone with all wisdom that we may present everyone mature in Christ. For this I toil, struggling with all His energy, that He powerfully works within me. In other words, I do what I do to present maturity in you, congregation. You, church. Ephesians 4, 11, 13 says, and He gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the shepherds, and teachers to equip the saints for the work of the ministry, for building up the body of Christ until we all attain to the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God to mature manhood. Right? Maturity. Maturity. Our duty as a body, as a church. The church is the Greek word ekklesia, called out. The called out, the gathering of the saints. Our duty is not to redeem culture. And if you read all the new Christian books, how to redeem society, how to redeem culture, that's not our job, is to redeem culture. God redeems culture. And God does that. We are called to be salt and light as we live in the world. The world will always be the world. Right? We've been called out of the world to be the body of Christ. You'll never change the world because that's the world. It'll never cease to be the world. The world will always be the world. The called out, the saints, the chosen will always be the body of Christ. You will never redeem culture. We're called to live in it. We're called to be in it, but not of it. We're called salt and light. Be that salt and light that you are. Our body, the duty of our body here, our congregation, which is Grace Church, is not to entertain ourselves. You are not here to be entertained. I'm not here to be entertained. We don't get together to have fun. Right? Sometimes it's not fun. Sometimes the Holy Spirit convicts us, and that's not always fun. We're not here to have fun. Parents, and I go out of my way not to do this. I do it all the time. For the sake of your child, don't ask your kids after they get out of children's church, do they have fun? I got the habit of doing that all the time. Lucas, did you guys have fun today?
Yeah.
Don't ask them that. Don't ask them if they had fun. Because what does that communicate to them? Well, they're supposed to be here. They're supposed to have fun. That's what it's about. Then what happens, parent, when all of a sudden it's not fun anymore and they don't want to sit there? They'd rather be outside playing with parents. Your question would have to change because you know what the answer is going to be. We don't get together out of duty or religion. That's not what we're called to do. We're not called to get together for out of duty and religious purposes. As a church, we don't come up with gimmicks or branding so that we might produce an image that others would want to be a part of. Churches, especially in the West, you may not have known, but we always try to get, we've got to get in on the branding. We've got to brand ourselves in such a way where we present this image that everybody will want to be like us. Everyone will want to be us. Let me tell you something. They don't want to be like you half the time, and they don't want to be with us half the time. So stop branding ourselves. We need to stop branding ourselves in such a way to make it worthwhile for them to be like us or with us. It's not the case. We don't need gimmicks. We don't need smoke machines. We gather together because we're called to be what the world isn't and to do what the world doesn't. We gather together because we are called to be what the world isn't, and we are called to do what the world doesn't do. This is a waste of time for the world. What you and I are doing right now is a waste of time. It is not profitable, and it is foolish. Well, we are as a people group that has been purified by Christ and to be a people of God's possession. We have been redeemed. We've been purified for the sake of being God's possession. Titus 2:14. What we do is something that the world, again, doesn't care to do and be. We've been called out of the world. How then do we mature together? How do we mature together? We mature together by engaging in many things. First off, mature together by being here. Do you know that by being here and doing what you are doing now is exactly what millions of people over the world die for, literally? Millions and millions and millions and millions and millions of people over many years have died doing what you take for granted today. I got an appointment to be at. I gotta do this, I gotta do that. We're called to join together. We're called to join together in heart, one heart and one mind, not drifting or flipping in and out of the body of Christ. A family is a family is a family. Each one is part of that. Romans 12:4-5 says, "For as in one body we have many members, and the members do not all have the same function, so we, though many, are one body in Christ, individually members of one another." This is demonstrated through membership. It's also demonstrated by a commitment to this body. If you find yourself flittering in and out of this body or some other body, don't stop. We're called to join together. We're called to be one member, to be one body, joined together by many individual parts, making up the body of Christ. There should be accountability in our body. We're called in James to confess our sins to one another. We're called to help one another and carry them along when they can't do it themselves, to bear their burdens. If you don't want to be held accountable, don't be. If you don't want to be held accountable for your spiritual maturity, don't be here. You'll get annoyed, I'll get annoyed, and it's just going to be an ugly picture. Go somewhere else. If you don't like people asking, "How's your walk with Christ going?" then you probably should not be here. But if you want others to help you move in such a way that you need to move, get on board and help them hold you accountable, and may you hold them accountable in the same way. If you don't want the elders asking questions or praying for you, don't be here. Call to be baptized. Call to be baptized together. In Scripture, I don't see this big separation between getting saved and being baptized. Anytime you see somebody getting saved, they were baptized. If you have not been baptized, please come see me. Anybody that has professed Christ as Savior, they were baptized. It was a public demonstration. Anybody that has ever been married, they got in front of witnesses. So if you've entered into a covenant with Christ, it's time that you get in front of the witnesses as a testimony. We serve. We serve one another. We serve the body of Christ. I was talking to John and Jess. We're talking about leading a whole here in the church. And I was referencing two things. Number one, there was the relational whole. That'll never be filled. Anytime somebody that has made an impact on the body of Christ here at Grace Church, when they leave, that hole is never really filled. However, that hole better be filled. That hole needs filled. That hole of service, where they have served, may those who are not serving serve in their place. If you don't serve somewhere, let me encourage you to serve somewhere. Don't let others bear the weight of the ministry of Grace Church without your help. The Holy Spirit has gifted you to use for the service of the body of Christ. If you are not serving, it's time to serve. If you're too old, you're not too old. If you think you're too young, you're not too young. You've come to Christ, you have the Holy Spirit indwelling you, you have been gifted by the Holy Spirit to do work for the body of Christ. This goes for the people that are always looking to have others building into them. If you are that person who never serve, you never give, you never put out, you were always being given something, you were always looking for handouts, you were always looking for help, you were always looking for somebody else to minister to you, always looking at somebody else to pray for you, maybe it's time you turn around and pray for somebody else, encourage them, stop looking for encouragement, make sure they're encouraged, make sure they're prayed for, making sure they have their needs met. And hey, here's something, if they're doing that and you're doing that, maybe God will be glorified there and everybody gets their needs met. That sounds like a pretty biblical church to me. Here at Grace, we need teachers. Jen, do we need teachers?
Yes, we need
teachers. We need teachers here. We need musicians, okay? We need a whole lot of help in a whole lot of places. You come see me, I'll show you. I'll point you in the right direction. We need to be preaching the Word of God. We need to be hearing the Word of God preached. This doesn't just mean watching me up here from home. Okay? There are times we haven't distributed. There are times it's necessary. You come in here with the gas door, I'm kicking you out. Because that means my kid's going to get it. That means I'm going to get it. And I've got a sensitive stomach. Nobody wants that. Okay? If something bad's happening and you came here, I totally understand. I get it. But number one, here is always better. You know why? First off, the quality in the streaming is not the best. Yeah, we're working on that. The sound isn't always the greatest. If you haven't figured that out. Secondly, it's always better that the same in the same room as the Word of God preached. There's an interaction here. There's an interaction. If you all just turned, got up and walked out, I was the only one here, that would affect me. Why? Because there's an interaction. As I preach, I'm preaching, you're here in my midst, receiving and applying it. There's something that happens. There's an interaction, that reciprocity that happens that can only happen when you're in the same room. I say that because I don't see us ever getting to the point where we're going to start some campus church where Brad's the only one preaching. We got tons of satellite church. We're looking at me on the screen. I really don't see that happen. So I'm not going to come across it anytime soon. So I can say that dogmatically. Now that's always better to be in the same room. Be here. Did I say that before?
Yeah.
Outreach. Be it through something we have at church, more so sharing the gospel with those you have in contact with. That's what we call being quiet Christians. Please, please, don't wait for ministry to start. Don't wait for there to be a function. You're called to be a light and salt. If you have a burden for somebody, don't come up to me and say, hey, we need a ministry to this and such demographic or this and this people. Maybe God has put you individually in a position that you need to be evangelizing. You need to be sharing the gospel of Christ alone with them. You know what happens is we as a church get to... Now, okay, hang on. I'm not saying that we as a church don't do outreach and should do outreach. Not at all. We do that. We do that. But... you and I need to, are the ones called to be salt and light. You and I are the ones called to be sharing the gospel. When Jesus left his disciples, he told them to go make disciples of the world. That was before the church was the church. So at some point, the responsibility to outreach laid on the church as a whole rather than the individuals in it. And I believe that's because a lot of individuals fail to personally evangelize and fail to share the gospel of Christ, all because they'd rather do it behind the scenes because they don't want to be in front of people to actually give them the gospel message. So they wait for there to be a program in the church. I don't want to step on toes. That's not true. The fact that I don't want to step on toes. That's not really what I want to step on toes. Pray. Be praying. Be praying for the health of this church. Be praying for the elders. Be praying for one another. On Wednesday nights, we gather together up in the conference room and we pray for the health of the church. In your shape groups, you need to be praying. Praying for one another. If you're not in a shape group, you're not being prayed for. I implore you, join a shape group so you might be able to engage in prayer with one another for individual needs. And as a church, pray for the health of this body together. Fellowship, learn to engage one another. Some of you don't like one another, and that's okay. Some of you can't fellowship with one another. Some of you as kids had on your report card doesn't play well with others. And it's the same thing now. That's okay. You're not called to like everybody. You're called to love them. If you don't like somebody, ask the questions why you don't like them and find out. If you don't like fellowshipping with somebody, find out why you don't like fellowshipping with them. And make a purpose of doing so. Encourage one another. Encourage one another. Hebrews 10:24, let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works. Get in the habit of encouraging one another. Encourage the elders. Okay? Encourage your elders. They need encouragement. We have some late meetings on Wednesday nights. Some very difficult meetings sometimes. Encourage them sometimes. Hopefully they encourage you. Worship, we sing. We gather together, we sing. That's what the people of God have been doing throughout the ages. Before the church was the church, the people of God have always gathered together and sung. Some of you think, well, I don't like all the songs. Fine. Some of the songs that you don't like, somebody else likes. The songs that they don't like, you like. If it's not a song with a tune that you love, fine. Pray the words to the Lord. I'm opinionated. I don't like all the songs. I don't like all the songs that I lead. At least in tune. When we worship, you're opening up our heart for the Lord. That's what we're doing. We are proclaiming to God His magnificence. And we are reminding ourselves and each other around us of the greatness of God as we sing. We give. Throughout the existence of mankind, God has always called His people, He had always called His possession to worship Him through money. Yeah. Why? Because that's what we hold on to the most, isn't it? It's easy to sing. It's easy to sacrifice out of the abundance of clothing we have or food we have here. But it's hard to sacrifice to the Lord when it comes out of our pockets, doesn't it? Oh, it's really hard. It's hard for me. It's hard for you. See, before the new covenant, Christ was the tithe. The tithe was financially 10%. And most of the time, it was another 10 to 20% of their other resources. Their other food, their clothing that they would bring to the temples. It wasn't just different. If you think, I practice the tithe, chances are you don't practice the true tithe. So before the new covenant, a good 20 to 25% was the standard of giving. Okay? Give. Learn to give sacrificially. Watching, there was an article yesterday, this morning, or today, my days kind of went together, watching Evangelist Television, some of you guys know the name, won't say the name. They're raising $650 million for a private jet. Private jet, they're raising $650 million. We ask for a chair sometimes. Gee whiz. We're not asking for Gulfstream. We're asking, my desire for you as a congregation is to get in the habit of giving sacrificially. Please, don't let the 20% bankroll 100% of the expenses of Grace Church. That happens. Not quite that figure, but oftentimes in churches that happens. Let Grace Church be the exception to that. Let us be the exception to that. Let 100% of us take on the 100% of the expenses. Imagine. We're in the black now, and that's good. Praise the Lord. We have never, the last 10 years, many years before I was here, we never ended in the red. You have to ask Wayne and Nancy when we ended in the red in the years, but more times than not, we ended in the black. Is that not true? Is that true? And praise the Lord. Sometimes just barely. Okay. This year, not quite there. We have the money, praise the Lord, for a good donation by somebody outside of the body. But oftentimes, we're not quite meeting there. We rely on individuals giving a large sum oftentimes. We can't plan that. If we all gave as God has blessed us, sacrificially, man, what we could do, what the comfort level we could be in, the amount of money we can send overseas, the amount of money we could in hiring somebody else to do ministry, we could do this, we could do that. God has blessed us. We are rich, rich people. Let us never be found in the position where we never God gave what God's supposed to give. Giving that which was His anyways. It's His money. He's got the cattle on a thousand hills. He's got what's in your pocketbook. He's got what's in your bank account book, not you. At some point in time, we have to enter into a covenant together as Grace Church. Not literally. For those of you that just aren't feeling any of this, what I've been preaching on today and before that, if you're not feeling it, if you're not feeling the shape group ministries, the BLD group ministries, the whole concept of maturity, if you're not really behind that and just get frustrated at it, it's probably not the place for you. For those that are opposed to the majority of this, I love you. I want you to want to mature. I can't make you. For all those where the majority of what I have just said, you ain't to end with that. For everyone else who believes that this is a reflection of what the body is supposed to be doing, my urge to you is buckle up, strap in, and enter this new phase together as a church. May we see the Spirit of God do amazing things in and through us for the next 75 plus years. We have turned. We've pivoted here at Grace Church. And to me, I know it feels like we're in a new phase. And it's true, we are. We've entered into this new phase. Things aren't now as they always have been. And so my urge to you, my invitation to you, is that you buckle up with me, come together and say, you know what? We know we want God to mature us. We know what God wants for us as a congregation. So we're going to do it together. It doesn't mean we're going to do it perfectly. It doesn't mean we're always going to do it in a loving way. But it means that we're together as a covenant of Grace Church that we're pursuing this together. We're not perfect. This is not the perfect church. I'm not the perfect pastor. I'm not the perfect preacher. But what I am calling for, what I am asking, is that you would come along with me, and you would come along and adopt what we believe to be God's will for us as a congregation and help bring us into a whole other phase where we are then able to pass it off to a new era, our kids down the road. It's not always going to be easy. It's not always going to be fun. I mean, it's time we stop looking to have fun, start looking to see how we can glorify God in our midst here at Grace Church. Amen? Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, God, we thank you for the occasion that you have brought us together here as a congregation. And I pray that now as we close, as we stand up, as we pray, as we sing, that you would be honored and glorified in our midst. And I pray that everything that I've preached today, God, it wasn't planned, it wasn't something that was rehearsed or edited or any of that kind of stuff, God. But I pray that your saints, that would reflect the saints' heart. And that would reflect your heart. And may we be and move in one accord here at Grace Church. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to have you